effect of cobalt and nickel in nickel substitutions in a structural and magnetic property of spinel ferrite. So I would like to discuss these things: introduction, experimenting methods, and research satisfaction. First, I introduce. Already, Casey ma'am has discussed so many things about the ferrite, but I have a little bit work on ferrite. So these are the ferrite that classified like this: cubic, hexagonal, and garnet, and almost perovskite. So my work is on spinel ferrite. So I would like to explain something about the spinel ferrite. So this is the spin structure of spinel ferrite. That is, out of 56 atoms, there are 32 are anions, and 8 are the divalent cations, and 16 are the trivalent cations. Likewise, they are arranged in FCC structures. And these are the classifications of the spinel ferrite. One is normal, second is mixed spinel ferrite, and third is partially filled spinel ferrite. This is play a very, very important role once you do the work on magnetic property. The distributions of the divalent and trivalent cations of their respective positions play important role in the context of magnetic as well as the electric and structural properties. So I have prepared this material, CoFe2O4, and I doped the cobalt with nickel, and finally I reduced the cobalt and prepared NiFe2O4. So I got these structures. First one is the mixed spinel ferrite, and second one is the mixed spinel ferrite, and third one is the inverse spinel ferrite. I will discuss later. So this is the method I applied for the synthesized material. The method is called the atomic machine method. This is the Ni in the form of titrate, nickel, cobalt, and ferric nitrate, and urea as a firing reagent. And in the same way, I mixed in the stoichiometric ratio and in the distilled water, put in a distilled water. After that, I took this material in a hot pellet, and slowly it is heating, and we get the gel type material. And then after I fired this material in a microwave oven, in this way, in the first I took the material in a beaker in a stoichiometric ratio. Then, liquid get converted into gel. After that, I put this material in a microwave oven and I fire this material and I get this type of ash particles. And after this, I am crushing this particle, and this is the final step of material. After that, I sintered this material to get the phase formation. And then after I sent the material in safe Kochi for XRD data. So I get the XRD data, and using that UDX file, I solve this data and refine it in foolproof software. I got this liquid refinement data, and this data I got. So this one is a good match, this blue line in this state. And this is a little bit not matching, and this one is also good match. So first one is the data I get from the liquid refinement. This is in the next slide, and this is your NiFe2O4, and this is NiCoFe2O4. The crystalline size I get 12 nanometer, 33 nanometer, and 23 nanometer, and the excited density goes on in increasing order. One, because the atomic mass of cobalt is getting larger as compared to the nickel, so this is, I guess, the increasing order, and the bulk density also going in the increasing manner. And the latest parameter that I calculated experimentally as well as the actual refining software, so both are in increasing order, because in my substitutions, first one is nickel, second I substitute the cobalt. So as the cobalt quantity of cobalt increases, the lattice constant goes on increasing, because the ionic radius of lattice constant is somewhat larger as compared to nickel. And after that, I send my material to IIT Powai for transmission electron microscopy. So I got around 50-40, and average, I didn't take the image software. So the average size I got 40 to 50 nanometer, and this is the SAD pattern. That is the small dot, this bright dot pattern that is indicating the material is crystalline in nature, so which is well matched and good agreement with the XRD data that I got. And then after I send the material, I have the Roorkee for calibrating sample magnetometer. This is first one is cobalt Fe2O4, and second one is mixed, that is Ni and CoFe2O4, and third one is purely NiFe2O4. So this one is highly magnetized material, and coercivity is also large. And this one is magnetization is 2.41, its magnetization is 0.38. And finally, this last one, that is NiFe2O4, its magnetization also negative magnetization as compared to this one, and 2.07. And coercivity also 0.37. So it is not a superferromagnetic material, but close to close resemble to superferromagnetic material, because the magnetization HC is not zero. The data generated from the filter software, they have got the CF file, the file transferred to this electron software. And they have distributed to cation in this manner. So this is, this first one is mixed spinner, second is mixed, and third one is again the inverse spinner pattern. So cobalt is distributed to tetrahedral side as well as octahedral side. And Fe is distributed both sides, octahedral as well as tetrahedral. So I calculate the Bohr magnetron of this sample by using its magnetic moment of CO and FE. I got this type of magnet. First is 4.6, 3.8, decreasing order. So I got the saturation magnetization goes on decreasing order. So further I thought that this magnetic material, Curie temperature of material, that is also depends on this Bohr magnetron also. Interaction between AA or BB and AB interaction, that is only depends on this parameter. So I didn't do this work now, I will feature plan this one. And I have some confusions. Solgen electroconversion method, the material successfully synthesized. And we conclude that from the XID pattern and SAID units, the material is single crystalline pattern. And the saturation magnetization and the saturation magnetization of the cobalt dope sample is get high. And nickel of only nickel sample is less. And secondly, we conclude that the effect of cobalt and nickel in the context of the magnetic property play very important.